just going to zoom it out. Biggest natural harbour in the southern hemisphere.
Over the other side of the harbour, to the left of the MCG there, that mangrove line in the start of East Arm, was where the Americans had five Catalina flying boats stationed from the early 30s. And of course a flying boat tender, an old World War I destroyer, converted. And when the raid started, some of the 36 Zero fighters that were part of that 188 aircraft, can you imagine 188 aircraft coming over the mangroves? Anyway, they were detached to dispatch the three that were still at their moorings. One American crew were paddling out to join the other two on patrol, recognised the aircraft as Japanese and paddled into the mangroves and gave us an eyewitness account on how quickly all three flying boats were sent to the bottom. The fourth was shot down by Japanese fighters off our Tiwi Islands, which go out that way about 80 kilometres, and you've got two large islands, second only to Tasmania. And quite simply, when they got shot down, there was a ship nearby. There were two ships, in fact, and they were picked up by the Florence D. Florence D and the Don Isidro were both blockade runners. They were very similarly loaded to the Neptune, only they also had lots of clothing, medicines, food. They were trying to get through the Japanese blockade to actually get to the Philippines, because when MacArthur fled the Philippines, he left an entire army behind, 100,000 soldiers, American and Filipino. Neither of those blockade runners made it, unfortunately. And quite simply, when Lieutenant Mora, the pilot of the Catalina that was shot down, saw what Florence D was carrying, he went to his crew and said, "I believe these are his words. If we even look like being attacked again, we're over the side, we'll take our chances with the crocodiles." Of course, she had a lot of munitions downstairs in her too. The Japanese attacked the Don Isidro first, and she was sinking. A lot of crew were lost. The captain drove her up on the Tiwi Islands to save what he could. The Japanese turned their attention to the Florence D. Moore and his crew had already gone over the side, I believe, and she was sent straight to the bottom. And when two of the patrol boats were sunk and sailors were killed, the Navy said not good enough. Came out and built this facility so they could just pull every patrol boat out of the water, trundle them along on rails, just like a train, on trolleys, and they've got turntables up there, and they can chain them all down to solid concrete, all behind that foliage. And of course they can put two in the shed, the green shed. So the green shed's been used for maintenance, you know, for work hardened aluminium, cutting out plates and replacing them and the like. And of course these are all Armidale class, and they're at the end of their useful life. They're being replaced, their replacement is being built in Henderson, West Australia. They're easy meat for fighters. They're relatively slow, they're limited in how high they can fly. For a fighter sights a flying boat, you're gone, you're toast, generally. That fifth Catalina actually sighted the four carriers off our northeast coast, radioed their exact position back to Darwin, turned and fled back and got here in one piece. And yet all four carriers had defensive umbrellas of Zero and Oscar fighters up. So I can only assume, we can only assume, that the commanders only let them go so far and said, "No, come back." Their main task was to protect the carriers. World War I had caused our government to create a competition, because we had an entire army in the desert under fire. They couldn't get them one square meal a day, let alone three a lot of the time. The competition was for a company to produce something that would survive the extremes of heat and cold in the desert. Something a soldier, this is leading to the question by the way, something a soldier can carry in his battle dress, and when they can't get a feed to him, he can nibble on it and it will sustain him. You know what I'm talking about?
Vegemite?
No. No one say chocolate. Some people have, and I just gone, "What, in the desert? Have you? You've never been in the desert." Any ideas? Anzac Vicky. Yes. It was originally called the Soldier's Biscuit. In those days.
Close.
We couldn't get any from World War I, so we went to Woolies. But honestly, we've been told so many times by diggers that have been on the boat and blokes that have been that were up here on the 19th, son, they're not even a third the size of a real Anzac biscuit. And by the time they got to us in the lines, they were so hard and stale, you couldn't eat them anyway. So we'd try things like soaking them in the tea. Sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't. You just threw them out and drank the tea.
So what's a bombing raid? Like you said, there's 77. Is that a wave of
84 is a wave in groups of nine,
okay,
and spread out and at different levels, so they don't bomb each other.
That's one wave.
But the whole 188 were all one big armada.
I see.
It's a big wing, it's called.
Yeah.
And the English used it a lot in the defence of London. The Battle of Britain, not only London. Remember the bloke in charge of the fuel pumps? Look over to your right and you'll see the pipeline. He on his own back managed to somehow get together the resources and the manpower to build three backup tanks. Because he didn't like that, 11 in one place, you know what I mean, with those shiny tops, you could see them so far away. And these three, he built right behind the foliage. You'll only see two, and you'll have to look real carefully to see them. There's one at the end of the pipeline there to the left, you might just get a glimpse of its cap.
F for France or frigate?
Frigate.
Or another word.
Both.
There you go.
We got it covered.
And MacArthur is a bunker ship, so that's fuel being put onto the bridge.
Years ago, two of our historians went to Japan and found records that we hadn't previously seen. And it told us the Japanese meticulously recorded 77 bombing raids on Darwin. Our gunners up here and around the place, which we'll get to real shortly, the government really, literally, in print, knocked them, said they were useless, only shot down six aircraft. In those records those historians got, we found that 28 Japanese aircraft were either shot down or had landed in the sea, crashed in the sea near the carriers, or when they'd landed on the deck were deemed beyond repair and pushed over the side. I reckon they did really well, because guess what? They had orders. There was a battery up here. This was the who's who of Darwin. This was the prime real estate of Darwin at the time, right? Roughly 5,000 people in Darwin. It fluctuated all the time, up and down. And the government in, I think it was 31, we can't nail that down precisely, sent the crews to five anti-aircraft guns to Darwin. Now, a battery, five batteries. A battery is four guns. 16 guns arrived in Darwin. You can do the maths on that, can't you? And the boys at the quarantine station, who had everything built beautifully, but no guns, chopped down trees and painted them black to make it look like they had guns from the air. This battery had the real McCoy, and they had a gunner who wrote, who kept notes, which was highly illegal in wartime, and wrote a book after the war. And Jack Mulholland, or Dutchie as he was known, told us we just got the four guns all ready to go. We got them, you know, bedded in and set up, and we got orders from Abbott in Government House. You will not practice fire your guns. I will not have the town people of Darwin disturbed. In other words, he meant the who's who of Darwin. Right? So Dutchie tells us the very first shells we ever fired out of these guns were going up as bombs were coming down. And this battery was credited with being the first in the Darwin region to open up, to open fire. They didn't have orders, they didn't have an air raid siren going off, they just decided they're Japanese and started firing. They had orders from their military commanders, you will land those bombs very accurately, right? So Dutchie tells us we could see the faces of the Japanese pilots as they came so low over the Esplanade. And we realised that if we kept firing with our fuses set like that, we'd be pumping shells into our own ships in the harbour. So we were left with no choice but to set the fuses at zero and risk the shell exploding in the barrel and killing us. Now, what generally leads into that is what's called a hot shot. And it's like someone's got icing sugar and put it all over the barrel. I know it well, believe me. Anyway, the simple fact is, it's the shell gets fired, jams in the barrel, doesn't clear the barrel. So you've got all that high explosive, all that heat, smack bang in front of you. In my day, they trained us, if it's going to explode, it'll explode in 3 seconds. You can go a fair way in 3 seconds, believe you me. But we were also taught, if it hasn't exploded after 10 seconds, it's not likely to explode. So go back and try and clear the gun and get it working again. Well, we only found in the records one hot shot, and that was at the Lee Point battery. We also found out in the records, they went back half an hour later. I reckon they had a cup of tea and a bicky, because can you imagine the heat in February? And you've got a hot shot, all that high explosion, all that heat, clear out. Yeah. Anyway, with World War I stuff. Anyway, and guess what? The army left it in there. So any boy or a girl of my age who grew up in Darwin would have played in a pillbox somewhere, because there were 17-inch bayonets, 303s, ammunition, 38 Webleys, ammunition, grenades. I don't understand how none of us ever thought, what happens if you pull this ring out in a grenade and blew ourselves to hell? And that situation survived. If you look now in line with the lighthouse, you'll see the entrance. And the door at the back that would have had, of course, a high tensile heavy steel blast door on it to protect the soldiers in. Can you see in line with the lighthouse? That's the business end. That's where the machine gun would have pointed out.
Actually assisted us, the people here, for the simple reason, once it caught a light, the black smoke obscured a lot of the targets that the Japanese had. And there's plenty of examples. Probably the best one is the Empire flying boat that was around at just in front of Stokes Hill Wharf, between Stokes Hill Wharf and the fuel farm, and it remained unscathed. And if you've been into the Royal Flying Doctor, it's Camilla was the name of it. There's a model of that plane, and its story is in there. But we're here because in front of us, above the broken pipeline, all disused of course, now you can see the memorial for the USS Peary. And it's this ship the memorial is for. It's the most significant American warship wreck in Australian waters, because simply 88 men are killed on her out of a crew of 158. The foredeck gun, you can just see the barrel from behind the foliage. You can see the three flagpoles in the clearing above the broken pipe. The gun actually points to the wreck site, and on the way back this afternoon, we will take you there and show you what's left on the echo sounder. But we'll, at the moment, just concentrate on what happened to her. She was involved in the evacuation by the Americans of the Philippines. Relatively lucky, you might think, but she sustained a lot of damage by attacks by American fighters and planes, and also was attacked by an Australian flight of Hudson bombers. And the reason given was that her radio, the Peary's radio, had been knocked out, and she failed to signal the code to identify her as an ally as opposed to a foreign vessel. And they actually dropped a couple of bombs on her before they realised that they were attacking one of their own ships. Peary arrives in Darwin. I'm not sure exactly when. She's accompanied by another big cruiser. This is a destroyer, by the way. The cruiser is much bigger, the USS Houston. And rearms, refuels and departs. And soon as she gets out of the harbour, has a submarine contact, an enemy submarine, and goes about trying to sink the sub. She uses up her fuel and ammunition and comes back in to refuel when the attack occurs on the 19th. Now, she's at anchor, so any ship at anchor is a sitting target, and she's not found after the war, I might add. She's found literally 2 kilometres away from where she was, her designated mortar was. The Americans sent out a recovery party to get their war dead back off the ship. Couldn't find it. This is after the war. A bit later on, when we show you the wreck, we'll give you the 2 stories, the local story and the official story.
We couldn't get the air conditioning working, so we ordered a sun shower instead.
Perfect. Thank you.
We're now pointing in approximately the direction the Japanese came from on the 19th of February 1942. It was a trick they'd used twice before, and no one had woken up to it. In Darwin, before they could be sighted from the mainland, the armada of 188 aircraft went out to the east, went 50 kilometres down our goat track, which was the Stuart Highway at the time, but it was a goat track. And then when they got to Noonamar, turned back and came back over Darwin from the south. So you can imagine what people thought. Thank goodness the Americans have come. My favourite story lets you know just how ill-prepared our military were. 2 gunners in HMAS Warrnambool, one of our corvettes in the harbour, that had a gun drill on the morning of the 19th. What timing, eh? And they were putting everything away on the foredeck 4-inch, that's the pointy end. And one tapped his mate on the shoulders and said, have we really got that many, do we really own that many aircraft? And his mate looked up and said, don't be stupid, they're American, we'll never own that many aircraft. Then the bombs started falling. So the poor civilians in town, if our military knew that much, or were that prepared for what was about to come down on their heads, what did the civilians know? Bugger all, Your Honour. Anyway, their first target was here. And if you look to your left there as we come around, you'll see 2 white caps. They're high volume heavy fuel tanks. And there, they still exist. They started building them in 24. Anyway, how did they come about? Well, Australia started worrying about defending Australia, where any threat would come from. And from 1910, they brought 3 senior British commanders, all experienced at war. Lord Kitchener, first before World War I, came through and said, any threat to Australia is going to come from the north. You've got to do something in the north. Admiral Henderson came through and said, you've got the largest natural harbour in the southern hemisphere. It should have a naval base and a naval fleet and an army on the ground. Any threat to Australia will be stopped in Darwin. We're dealing with politicians, all right, so this drags out. Anyway, then Viscount Jellicoe came through and he presented a comprehensive plan. A large main naval fleet in Singapore with an army, a large combined naval fleet in Darwin with an army, and backups in Port Stephens, New South Wales, and Coburn Sound in West Australia. Would have changed the whole place of the Pacific War. But all 3 governments, would you believe, yeah, the New Zealanders were involved in this too, said, any idea how much it's going to cost? No way. And nothing was done. 1923, the British called an imperial conference, during which time they convinced the Australian and New Zealand governments to ignore all the advice they'd had from their most experienced, most senior commanders, because it had all changed. What had changed? Nothing really. They convinced our governments they would have a Royal Naval Fleet in Singapore. They didn't. They convinced our governments they'd have a large army in Singapore. They did. But they convinced our governments that no one could ever get past Singapore. They didn't take into account men on bicycles, because that's what took Singapore. Anyway, during that conference, they asked the Australian government to establish a naval refueling port in North Australia somewhere. Well, largest natural harbour fell on Darwin. And the idea was, of course, they're looking at ships, allied ships, coming from Melbourne, even Adelaide, Perth, Sydney, and the distance to London was enormous, but it was large enough even to Kuala Lumpur or Singapore. So the Australian government jumped straight onto it, and they had 11 tanks designed and started construction in 1924. Put a military commander in charge of it. He said, you're joking. Are you bloke serious? 11 tanks all in the one place, all smack bang on the waterfront with 8 metre tides. Sorry, you would have said 26 foot tides back then. That's what we have in Darwin Harbour. And quite simply, he was told to just do as he was ordered by the politicians. I didn't know they had so much swing back then. Anyway, they didn't in my day, I don't think. Simple fact is, they started construction in 24, the depression interfered, they managed to resume construction and completed the 11th tank, filled it with heavy fuel oil 5 days before the Japanese bombed them. Great. On the day the Japanese bombed them, we had a 7.5 metre tide flowing out. Can you imagine the power of that? That building there, the jetty, now a restaurant, pump station, has been all kinds of things, power station for Darwin at one stage, that has a recording device, and they've recorded 14 knots of tide right there. Multiply that by 1.852 and you know how many kilometres. That's a lot of water moving at a fair rate. Very powerful. Anyway, Japanese decision to bomb the fuel farm number one target is what saved a lot of Darwin. And we'll get to that. They had lost so many experienced pilots and aircraft 10 weeks earlier in Pearl Harbor, they were determined not to do the same in Darwin. So they changed their tactics totally. They used a torpedo bomber, which six ships, as a level bomber, 19 to 26,000 feet up. 84 of those first aircraft was only single engine torpedo bombers, only carry one bomb, but an 800 kilo bomb under the first 84. And their target, that 84, they were the Cates, was everything on land. All the infrastructure, gun emplacements, everything they could destroy, starting with the fuel pump. So they still managed to get six of those tanks. Their idea was to wipe Darwin off the face of the earth. They didn't want it used to mount a counter-offensive against them in the Dutch East Indies, Indonesia. And Darwin was a place they knew that it could accommodate an entire battle fleet, because 2 weeks earlier, the American Asiatic, as Jim mentioned. So they still got six of those tanks. Can you imagine all that heavy fuel oil just pouring straight into the ocean and being spread by that outgoing tide? The pipeline where the ships refueled went here to number two target, Stokes Hill Wharf. And that's where the warships and ancillary vessels would tie up and refuel. And that's where they've identified the ignition point. That's where a bomb ruptured the pipeline and ignited that heavy fuel oil. Once you ignite heavy fuel oil, it can take weeks even, but definitely days and days to contain it. And it floats on the surface. A lot of the sailors that survived the sinking of their ships that day were lost in the fire. But some extraordinary stories. The Qantas boatman got out his relatively small flying boat tender, did many, many trips into the harbour, and pulled 170 sailors, literally some of them from the burning oil well. For that, he was awarded the highest award for bravery a civilian can get, and justifiably so. The hospital ship Manunda took two bombs. Medical staff and crew were killed, but she remained afloat. She had working operating theatres, saw what was happening in the harbour, all the bodies in the water, and sent her lifeboats out and pulled many hundreds more back to the Manunda. We'll never know the final figure because quite simply it became blurred. Manunda was the only hospital in the region that could deal with the wounds of war, the horrific wounds caused by fire and explosions and the like. Darwin Hospital is probably better for childbirth, broken bones, and so a lot of the wounded from the shore were actually ferried out to the Manunda and treated there. Stokes Hill Wharf, alongside here on the day, on the morning of the 19th, the Neptuna came in. She was a freighter loaded with munitions, a floating bomb really, 450 tons of depth charges, 4-inch ammunition, 303 belts for our sloops and corvettes, rifles and 303s for our soldiers. How important was that ship? We had roughly 3,000 soldiers in Darwin, half of them were Chocos. If you don't know what that means, it was a derogatory term for our reserve soldiers, chocolate soldiers, melt in the sun. And that, of course, changed where Gona and Milne Bay and the Kokoda Trail, guess who stopped the Japanese army for their first ever defeat on land? Our Chocos. Anyway, in Darwin, those 1,500 odd soldiers had one rifle every five soldiers, right? Every soldier had five rounds of ammunition. How long is that going to stop an invasion? And it was only early last year, that the penny dropped with me. That was Stalingrad. Exactly. They issued one rifle to every five soldiers and told the others to follow him when he fell, put their five rounds through when they fell. Only in Russia, of course, when they retreated against the German onslaught, their officers shot them as they fell back. I'd like to hope that wouldn't have happened. But anyway, how the heck did we ever get to that? One rifle every five soldiers. So the Neptune on the morning of the 19th, three holes are wide open. She should have been unloaded weeks earlier. The wharfies in Darwin were terribly militant and they constantly had disputes. And so she'd been held off, sitting in the harbour. Also sitting in the harbour for a few days was one of our sloops coming back from Timor, attacked many times by the Japanese, critically low on ammunition. She can't get to it. So when Neptuna comes alongside, the wharfies open up three holes, HMAS Swan goes alongside, the wharfies start unloading the ammunition and handing it over to the Navy when the bombs start falling. The wharfies get out of there. One wharfie says, hang on, the Navy are helping themselves. Unbelievable, but true, you can check it. They sent their two heavies back to kick the Navy off the Neptuna. They approached the petty officer in charge of the naval ammunitioning party and said, get your men off this ship. What they're doing is illegal. Only wharfies can unload this freight. All well documented. Charged because in the inquiry that followed, their leadership was proved to be totally ineffective. And a main part of our army fell back. But that was given a green tick because the commanders realised when the Neptuna went up, what chance did they have of defending Darwin if there was a seaborne invasion? None. So they fell back on the Adelaide River. Their reasoning? It's a wide, fast-flowing river full of crocodiles and surrounded by dense monsoonal jungle. And their words were, we believe we could at the very least slow the Japanese army down here, if not stop them. Number four, the wedding cake. That was built on the site of the original post and telegraph station. Very, very important target for the Japanese. In 1871, the Overland Telegraph had arrived in Darwin from Adelaide, and solid copper came out of the water from Java. And by 1872, they managed to put it all together and get it working. So Australia actually linked to the rest of the world in 1872, telegraphically. It was still a bit slow, 6 days to London, you know, it was still da-da-da, Morse code. But it could previously take up to 10 weeks to get communications between our governments from one to the other. Anyway, so we don't know exactly how many aircraft hit that, but they destroyed it quite comprehensively. The nine people that were in there heard the bombs going off in the fuel farm, got in their slit trench. Now, their slit trench was considered the best in Darwin, even had a roof on it, but slit trenches are designed to protect you from flying shrapnel, from exploding bombs, exploding shells. They have one weakness, and they took a direct hit from an 800 kilo bomb. So nine in the slit trench died instantly, and the 10th person, who was a telegraphsman who'd been in the workshop, was running to dive into the slit trench when the bomb exploded. He died from his wounds the following morning. So what they found when they were excavating for Parliament House was the remains of that slit trench and the bomb crater. So they marked it, and now if you walk into Parliament House, which you can get in just like going through an airport, and they've got lovely coffee and lunch, you probably know that already. Anyway, simple fact is, on the ground floor directly over the side of that slit trench is a plaque in memory of those postal workers that lost their lives in that very first wave of that very first wave. So we're looking at target number three, Government House.
Oh, yeah.
That beautiful old building up there was completed in 1872. It was a big year for Darwin. And it's been our Government House.
That's nice.
That house has survived three cyclones that have flattened Darwin and survived the bombing.
Wow.
How? Well, two bombers were assigned with their 800 kilo bombs to Government House. One failed to explode. The one that did explode didn't do much damage to the main house at all. Knocked over a brick wall, unfortunately, and it collapsed on one of the housemates who was getting into the underground bunker to get away from the shrapnel. But the building stood proud, so you could imagine what people thought about that. People in Darwin, they looked and said, well, obviously the Japanese are coming. They've saved that house for their senior officers and their headquarters. And they fled, and that became known as the Adelaide River Star.
No worries, let's see how we go. It's
low tide. Oh, shell's stuck in there. It's high tide to go up the road.